Welkom by ons goue jare met die uwe André Walters. Ons goue jare is 'n gereelde weeklikse halfuur hier op die gunsteling radiostasie vir ouer mense en hulle kinders en kleinkinders, sodat hulle ook kan verstaan wat die uitdagings is van ouer word. As die tee of koffie reg is, kan ons wegval. Op die spyskaart vandag in ons goed om te weet gleuf, gesels ons verder met Piet Matthee van die Suid-Afrikaanse Vereniging van Afgetredenes, SAVA, en hy praat oor die sogenaamde Living Wills. Baie interessante gesprek met hom daaroor. En die nostalgie gleef Louis Armstrong met What a Wonderful World. Ek het nog altyd met hom saamgestem. En onderuit van die week gesels ons verder met Anthony Turton. Wat een merkwaardige man. Hy was in die geheime dienst gewees en het oor die grens gegaan en Mozambique in en al sulke dinge. En hy is nou voorste kenner oor water, Dr. Anthony Turton. Ons gesels verder met hom. En Frans van Stemmet is natuurlik terug met Boererate. En nou is het tyd vir Goed om te weet met SAVA, die SA Vereniging vir Afgetredenes, die voorste organisasie vir senior mense. We've started a chat with Piet Matthee, who is an attorney, about the importance and the responsibility to have a proper will drawn up in your life. And Piet, who is also the chairperson of SARP, the South African Association of Retired Persons, is back on the line. Hello there, Piet.
Hi, André. Thank you very much.
We said we'll talk about living wills. I had a problem. I wanted a living will and I couldn't get through to that organization in Durban. They don't answer their phone.
Yes, André, we've had complaints like that also. But maybe I should just start off by saying that the name living will, of course, is a bit of a misnomer in that it is not a will in the ordinary sense of the word at all. Oh. It is a declaration or an advance directive in which a person expresses his or her directives by refusing consent to any medical treatment and attention which will keep him alive
artificially.
By artificial means.
Yes.
When he or she is no longer competent to express his or her instructions.
If you're in a coma, for example.
Exactly.
And you will never recover. But they keep pumping food into you through your veins and things like that.
Yes, exactly. That is, what it makes provision for. The Living World Society, as I say, and I don't know whether they are still active, but they suggested that one should have three copies of the living will to be signed by the person in the presence of two witnesses.
Yeah.
And, of course, that copies of this living will should be kept in a safe custody box and should not be attached to the person's last will, as this document is often only read after the person's death. One copy of the living will should be lodged with the member's doctor after full discussion of the contents, so that the doctor understands his patient or the member's directives in advance of the possible need.
Wow.
And two copies should be kept at home in a safe place for easy access by someone other than, of course, the member. One being one's own personal copy and the second one being for inclusion on an inpatient file,
yeah,
should the need for hospitalization in a hospital, nursing home, or hospice, for instance, arises.
In essence, really, Piet, what you're saying is that the individual is making a life-altering decision while they still have the capacity to do so.
The mental capacity to do so.
Yes, yes, yes.
You see, André, maybe I should just very briefly read, you know, a paragraph out of the out of a draft Living Will,
yes,
where it would say that should I no longer be capable of making decisions for my own future, and should my physical and or mental condition deteriorate to such an extent that there is no reasonable prospect of my recovery from physical illness or impairment, which is expected to cause me severe distress or to render me incapable of rational existence, I request that, firstly, I be allowed to die. I further request that no systems be used in order to keep me alive in circumstances where, but for the use of such systems, I would have died. And secondly, that I be given whatever quantity of drugs which may be required to keep me free from pain or distress, even if the moment of death is hastened thereby.
Wow. Now, Pete, this is a legal document. In other words, they have to do what you say in that living will.
Yeah. Andre, that unfortunately, you know, is not so clear because the South African Law Commission did investigate this subject and issued a discussion paper during January 2004, which contained proposed legislation, but sadly no draft bills or other discussion papers have been issued since. And therefore, there is a lot of uncertainty as to the legal status and enforcement of such living wills. But the fact of the matter is it is still an instruction, and if one could say a wish, rather, to your loved ones and to your doctors, which could make, I think, life and decisions by them in that critical stage a lot easier.
So a doctor is not obliged to keep you alive artificially?
You see, that is where the difficulty of euthanasia comes in. As I understand the law, he is not not obliged to keep you alive artificially, but he also cannot contribute to you dying even in a passive way.
Well, yeah, so a living will is not about euthanasia. It is
about
withholding artificial.
It is, although it may sound like that, it is really in the end a wish to your loved ones and to your doctors not to keep you alive under circumstances, of course, where they are not obliged to do so. I may just read to you also from a draft from the last, or from a living will, where a member expresses, you know, that my doctor, where one says, it's my express wish that my doctors or members of my family who carry out my foregoing requests be fully exonerated and exempt from all blame or liability arising from their use or their failure to use or their decision to terminate the use of any systems. But I must say, Andre, that, of course, you know, again, is a wish, and I mean, no court has to comply, of course, with that. But I think it is important in the sense that, as I've explained, it is still a wish, and it will really make life a lot easier for one's loved ones.
So really what you're also saying is that it would be a good idea to distribute this living will to your children as well.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, definitely. Of course, I think it is a very personal a document, you know, and that one should restrict it, you know, to whom you would give it.
Yeah. If you are a member of SARP, the South African Association of Retired Persons, then SARP, to you, will be able to provide living wills for members of SARP.
Yes.
And membership is absolutely free.
Yes, Andre, that is correct, you know, but if I can just explain this, we can, of course, not just, you know, as attorneys and also not as SARP, just hand out forms and, you know, that one can then say that it comes from us, but we take no responsibility for it.
Yeah.
Therefore, we are prepared to give this as an extra service where we are instructed by members to draft their wills, and where we are appointed as, that means both SARP and ourselves, as co-executors of a member's estate, we will gladly also include the drafting of a living will if the member so desires, at no cost to the member.
What I like about this idea is that SARP and Matia attorneys will be objective, will be able to help make decisions for children or spouses that are absolutely objective, not emotional and
exactly.
You know, and I think this is terribly important to have that kind of presence when the person passes on.
Yes, and you see, of course, also we guarantee a professional service to our members, you know, and also members will have the peace of mind that they are dealing with a firm of attorneys who specialize in the drafting of wills and the administration of estates. And, of course, we are covered by the Fidelity Fund, you know, should anything go wrong.
Well, I can tell our listeners that Pete is drawing up my will for me, and he will include living wills for both me and my wife. And that gives me great peace of mind, Pete, really.
I'm so glad to hear that, Andre, yes. And that is the kind of service that we would like to provide to all our members.
But I am a member of SARP. So,
and we are so glad about that, yes.
Yeah. Pete, thank you so much. Is there anything you would have liked to have added?
No, thank you very much, Andre. I would just like to, again, as I say, invite all your listeners, you know, to contact us. If they are not members as yet, they are free to join. It doesn't cost them anything.
I found it a
very
quick,
simple,
very easy process. A telephone call, and
exactly.
and there's my membership card in the post.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. No, Pete, thank you so much, and have a wonderful rest of the week.
Thank you so much, Andre, and the same to you and your listeners.
Dit was Piet Matthee van SAVA, se Afrikaanse Vereniging vir Afgetredenes. Ons gesels volgende week. Ray Hatting oor, net gou kyk, waar is my lysie? Met Ray Hatting, en hy praat oor die bevestiging van sociale clubs en hoe SAVA mense help om dit recht te kry. It's Good to Know is brought to you every week on Our Golden Years with the compliments of SARP, the South African Association of Retired Persons. SAVA, die SA Vereniging vir Afgetredenes, 'n uitsonderlike organisasie vir mense 50 jaar en ouer. Lidmaatskap is absoluut gratis en alle inkomste kom deur klein kommissies van die talle diensverskaffers wat ons lede help.
SAVA het 'n verstommende reeks van verskeie dienste soos familietrusts en testamente, alles teen groot afslag vir ons lede, maar daar is soveel meer.
Korttermynversekering deur 'n hele reeks van die voorste maatskappye.
'N Vakansieklub met 'n wye reeks van top vakansieplekke met tariewe teen 'n byna ongelooflike groot afslag.
Begrafnisdienste, ook teen 'n groot afslag.
'N Gratis afslag en loyaliteitskaartjie met voordele en besparings op die Mahala loyaliteitsprogram en waarmee jy jou eie afslag as 'n senior burger kan beding.
Die SAVA leefstyl skeepvaarte waar jy rustig op die dek kan lê en droom op die oseaan.
'N Gratis gereelde SAVA nuusbrief met noodsaaklike inligting en artikels vir mense ouer as 50.
Besoek www.sarp.net. Spel dit SARP of skakel hulle by 021-592-1279 en sluit vandag aan. Kry jou gratis lidmaatskap kaartjie en geniet die lewe baie meer vir baie minder. Ek weet nie hoe voel julle daaroor nie, maar ek onthou met groot nostalgie die dae van Louis Armstrong, ou Satchmo, en veral hierdie lied, What a Wonderful World.
I see trees of green, red roses too, I see them blue, for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, them grow, they're like much more than I ever knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful.
Dit was Louis Armstrong met What a Wonderful World. En nou is het tyd vir ons onderhoud van die week. Ons gesprek met Anthony Turton is regtig baie interessant en hier is hy weer. You know, we're not all blessed to be able to say that we made a difference in any way. And I know you as a friend that you feel exceptionally blessed by the opportunities that you've, A, have come your way, and B, that you've created yourself.
Yes, you know, I've always grappled. I've always been a thinking person from a young child. I've always been a thinker. And sometimes to be a thinker, it's a burden. And in fact, when you're a soldier, it's not good to be a soldier that's a thinker as well, because then you start thinking things through that you shouldn't think through. You should just follow orders. But as a thinker, you know, I mean, I'm a 12th generation African, and I'm deeply proud of this whole thing. I always considered myself to be an African.
Yes.
And, you know, through my work in the intelligence service, particularly in amalgamation of statutory and non-statutory forces after CADESA, the successful negotiation of the Constitution, I was deeply introspective about my identity as an African. And I think today in the contemporary South Africa, where everything is being re-racialized and growing tensions and lack of leadership, etc., I'm deeply reflective about the fact that I consider myself an African, even if others don't.
Yeah.
And I had a long conversation with the political commissar of the armed wing, APLA, the armed wing of the Pan-Africanist Congress at the time, and about this whole issue of identity. And even when I was in Mozambique with the special operation that I spoke about, I managed to connect with the RENAMO fighters on this issue of identity. So I've always believed in my bone, I'm a 12th generation African, I am an African. And I always grew up with the belief that my son would become a 13th generation African and my grandson a 14th generation. And tragically, my son is now an Australian and my grandson is in fact a first generation Australian. So this has been a tremendous shock for me, something that I've had to really think about very carefully. What does it mean to be an African? As a white South African citizen, do I have the right to call myself an African? And do other people have the right to deny me of my Africanness? So this is something that I've reflected on very deeply. And in my book, Shaking Hands with Billy, I've tried to deal with that issue because, you know, my father was a Zulu. He spoke fluent Zulu. He spoke Zulu as a first language. He had a Zulu name. Mganga Bodwe was his name. Yeah. You know, he grew up in the most rural of areas of Klabisa, Zululand. Yeah. I was down there, in fact, just about 2 weeks ago. And I've always felt a deep connection to that place. And I will not allow anyone to deny me that right. Yeah. And I believe, once again, as a veteran, that we should maybe let our voices be heard. And I'm trying to do this through some poetry that I'm writing now, some war poetry that talks about the wisdom of, you know, of what you learn when you are lying in a foxhole in the ground somewhere in Angola and a big is strafing you. And what these angry young men today that so glibly talk about going back to war, what they have not learned. So I'm very sort of introspective about that stuff.
You know, Anthony, I can so identify with you. My family were Trekboers, and they ended up in the Eastern Cape. And my great grandfather's name was Ngonyama, which means lion.
Yes.
And everybody called him Ngonyama, even his white friends.
Yeah.
And he had a voice. A very powerful voice. He could stand on one hill and talk to you in a conversational tone on the top of the other hill.
Yes, but you know, this issue of identity is so important because you know, I have a traditional name, Kabalaza, which means to always be in a hurry. My brother's got a traditional name called Majamela, you know, the one that stands and watches but never speaks.
Yeah.
And my mother's got a name, Nomsa, the caring one. But my children don't have names like that because these names are given by the community.
Yeah.
And this, of course, reflects the way that actually we were very deeply integrated prior to 1994.
Yes.
And only in the 1980s did we start separating as a result of all the tensions in the country.
Yeah.
And some years later, when I was now senior officer in the newly established South African Secret Service, I was a founding member of that. And I served under Nelson Mandela in that. And I'm very, very proud of that role as well. And I was commissioned as an instructor in the military college, teaching officers on strategic level of training when they were transitioning from colonel to brigadier general. And I met the corps commander, Colonel Buthelezi.
Yes.
And, of course, Buthelezi is clearly a Zulu name. And I went to pay my respects to the colonel. And I told him that, you know, my name, I'm a son of Mganga Bodwe from Klabisa. And he immediately said, that white boy from Klabisa, my mother still speaks about that boy to this day. And immediately he got on the phone. Here was an MK man, you know, an MK man, now in the SANDF, a senior officer, colonel, and he recognized me. I was formerly his enemy, you know, from the armed struggle.
How
and yet I'd made my peace. We'd been beaten our swords into plowshares. We'd created the enabling environment for peace. And suddenly he recognized me as another fellow Zulu.
Yes.
And I mean, that was a profound moment for me.
Yeah.
And, you know, just gave
and
me
a man like Buthelezi.
Sense of hope and warmth and belonging.
Dr. Anthony Turton's merkwaardige boek, Shaking Hands with Billy, merkwaardige greep uit ons onlangse geschiedenis, kan gekry word op www.shakinghandswithbilly.com. Boederate met Frans van Stemmet. En Boederate gesels Frans van Bikkie verder oor parasiete en wat een mens daaromtrent kan doen.
Ek het ook een Hollandse vriend gehad. Hy was een wetenskaplike. En hy het vir my gesê, hierdie mense wat so in die straat rondloop met sulke geswolle enkels,
ja.
Hy sê, hulle kolon is vuil. Hy sê, jou kolon verskaf die suurstof in jou systeem. Maar as die wande bedek is met gemors,
ja.
kan hy nie.
Ja.
So wat jy moet doen is, jy moet op 'n colon detox gaan. En jou systeem na die detox letterlik met water uitwas. En hy sê vir my, hy het dit met kliënte van hom, hy was nie 'n dokter, hy was 'n dokter, maar wetenskaplike dokter, maar hy het dit met kliënte van hom toegepas. En hy sê, na 2 weke, dan is hy enkels gesak, want daar is weer bloedsomloop.
Ja.
Daar is weer suurstof in die
maar wat, wat doen hy dan? Wat is die behandeling?
Kyk, jy kry by jou apteek, kry jy detoxmiddels, kolon skoonmakers.
Dis nou nie die decolonization hierdie nie, nie.
Hoopelik nie. Maar as jy lang aangeramede, gaan jy jouself decolonize. Nee, jy koop die ding en jy lees baie seker hoe jy dit moet gebruik.
Ja.
Gewoonlik is dit 'n behandeling vir 8 of 10 dae.
Ja.
Die goed wat hy gebruik het, ek dink een of ander peroxide, natriumperoxide ding.
Maar jy kan met jou apteker daar oor praat.
Jy kan met hulle daar oor praat. En kry vir jou die ding. En na die behandeling het hy nie aanbeveel nie, hy het gesê jy moet 'n water enema doen.
Ja. Ja.
Dat jy jou systeem kan skoon was. Hy sê, jy kan nie glo wat uit jou dikdarm uitkom nie. Harde goed, wat die wande van die dikdarm bedek, waarmee jou liggaam suurstof kry.
Ja.
Jy weet, dit is, en die ding wat ook nog parasiete en goeders veroorsaak, is gemorskos. Nou, ek is nie een van die ouens wat alle kitskos as gemorskos afmaak nie. My argument is, daar gaan oordentlike vleis in die patties in, hopelik.
Ja.
Maar daarom hou ek dan van om my eie patties te maak.
Ja.
As jy gesonde patties het, en jy sit gesonde gewaste, blaarslaai daar op, en skoon gewaste tamaties, en jy weet, sousie, dan maak jy 'n wonderlike hamburger.
Ja.
Ek kan nie sien wat daarmee kan verkeerd wees nie.
Ja.
Maar dis kitskos plekke.
Ja.
Nie almal nie, maar baie. Wat mors met die kos.
Ja.
En daar kom jy goed vandaan.
Dis waar die naam gemorskos van hang kom.
Exactly, dit is precies dit. Nou, hulle sê ook dat pasta, pizzas, alle stysel en proteïene wat jy meng, soos pap en vleis, rys, vleis, aardappels, brood en suiker, daar kom die groot ding in. Ek is baie lief vir brood, ek is baie lief vir soetgoed. Ek sal nie so ver gaan om my kinders of my kleinkinders een sweets te steel nie. Maar
jy was al getenteer geweest.
Deel, jy weet. Maar waarvan moet jy wegbly? En daarmee gaan ons hierdie week afsluit. Alles soetgoed, pastye, broodrolletjies, alle suurdeegprodukte. Vir my, dis nie 'n lekker ding nie, vir my alkohol. Dit verander in suiker. Vir my kaas en gedroogde vrugte. Dit is vir my ook 'n onverstaanbare ding, jy weet, gedroogde vrugte. Grondbone en grondboontjie botter. En dan sê hulle, sampioene. Nou, sampioene gaan ek van my lysie aflaat. En gedroogde vrugte ook. En kaas ook. Want, vat dit weg, saam met die brood en die...
Dan gaan jy van die honger dood.
Dan, ja, dan, hoe moet jy lewe en hoekom moet
ja,
jy
precies.
Dankie, François. Lekker gewees. Ons gesels weer volgende week. As jy met ons wil skakel, of luister na vorige episodes, doen het gerus op www.facebook.com/1 ons gouwe jare. Daar kan jylle ons kry. Nou, tot volgende week. Hou kop, hou koers en hou boete, hou uit.